let your Father do sing all the bless you tonight. We'll thank you for your doctor word. We'll thank you for your healing presence, Jesus. We'll thank you for being our God. We'll thank you for being our source. Lord, we thank you for everyone connected to this podcast from around the world. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for bringing us to a granted word tonight. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your presence, Jesus. You are here. We lift our hands before you. You are the King of Kings. You are Jireh. You are the answer. You are the reason why we worship. You are the reason why we need. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name today. Amen. You can take a seat. Hallelujah.
Glory be to God.
Today we are sharing on something very important. I believe that what I'm about to share tonight has the potential to actually help us fulfill our destinies.
Hallelujah.
My passion is to see people rise beyond obscurity. It's to see people make a difference with the gift of life. It's to see people maximize what God has entrusted to their care. To see people do something great with the gift of life. And these are the things that inspires my teaching. And tonight, we'll be talking about destroying the roots of rebellious spirits. Destroying the roots of rebellious spirit. Now, this spirit is a dirty spirit. Very dirty spirit. Rebellious spirit is a very dirty spirit that can rob people the joy of living. That can rob people the joy of manifesting the greatness within them. There are a lot of people today that would have rise to the top, but because of this spirit, they miss their place of destiny. Because of these spirits, they miss their destiny because of their inability to deal with this spirit. Now, there are reasons why people can be rebellious. One of the reasons why people can be rebellious is when they get offended. When people get offended, they can choose the path of rebellion unknown to them that their action has effect on their future. When people offend them and they can't handle the offense, it can open door for a rebellious spirit. When people are offended, another reason why people can be rebellious is when people are jealous. When people are jealous, it can open door for a rebellious spirit. When people are jealous, it can open door for a rebellious spirit. Another reason why people can be rebellious is when people choose to contend with another person. When they choose to contend with another person, they can open the door to this spirit. When people choose to contend with leadership, contend with authority, it can open the door of a rebellious spirit. When people choose to hate, hatred can open the door of rebellion. Hatred can open the door of rebellion. It can open the door of rebellion. When people choose not to listen, it can also open the door for the spirits. It can open the door for this way. This is why many marriages never make it to the top. It is either the man is a rebellious man or the woman is rebellious. So they have what is called divorce. The majority of the cases that people have divorce is connected to rebellion, people's inability to submit to one another. Rebellion removes submission from the scheme of things. I said what? Rebellion will remove submission from the scheme of things. If you want a relationship to work, this spirit has to be dealt with. And there are so many people today that this spirit has set them backward in their lives. And this rebellious spirit is a killer of relationship. It's a killer of relationship. Many destiny relationships were destroyed by this spirit called the spirit of rebellion. And the reason why people like Judas never made it to the top was because of this. The reason why people like Demas never made it to the top was because of this spirit. There were people also, when God was talking to me tonight, when I was talking about preparing for this meeting, he said there were people who had an opportunity to be rebellious, but they refused to. Number one was Joseph. Joseph, one of the sons of Jacob. When the situation that was going around his life, he has the tendency to be rebellious, but he refused to be rebellious. That was a man who decided to walk in the path of humility. One of the key door to overcoming the spirit of rebellion is to choose a lifestyle of humility. And to choose a lifestyle of humility begins with the formation of God's word in you. To choose a lifestyle of humility begins with the formation of God's word in you. Because without the spirit of humility, if you couldn't choose the power of humility, but you cannot address the spirits. Because it is a spirit that makes people feel like they are more important than they are. Rebellious spirit is a spirit that makes people have a what is called false identity. Rebellious spirit is the reason for what? For false identity. People begin to exalt themselves beyond measure. And people begin to see themselves more than every other person. I'm more better than this person. And what is actually a person that is a rebellious spirit? And this is why most people can never be happy with their life, with their dreams, with what God has called them to do, because this spirit has ruined their strength, have ruined their passion, and the things God has called them to do. This spirit does not tolerate evil. It doesn't care whether you're big or you're small. It can jump on any individual and then ruin their life. It doesn't care whether you're old. It doesn't care whether you're young. What it cares is his mission. And this is what makes Satan, Satan. Satan, the major part of Satan is made up of the rebellious spirit. What makes Satan, Satan, that was why Satan said, I will ascend. And he was thinking about overthrowing God. This what causes is the same spirit. It is this spirit that makes Satan, Satan. Satan is called Satan because of a rebellious nature. It has it in him. And this is what makes him the devil, because his mission is to flat leadership. His mission is to always disagree with leadership. How this spirit works is that, well, how do you know that someone is rebellious? Number one, they have no honor for leadership. They have no honor for leadership. How do you know that a person is rebellious? They have no honor for leadership. A God-ordained leadership, they fight against leadership. The primary mission of the rebellious spirit is to fight against authority. It's to fight against authority, because authority plays a vital role in the lives of people. So this spirit comes to fight people to ensure that they don't obey authority. And when people fail to obey authority, they can't fulfill their destiny. When people fail to obey authority, they can't do what God has called them to do. Whatever God has called you to do, he will put you under leadership. I said, whatever God has called you to do, he will put you under a leadership. Whatever God has called you to do, whatever God has anointed you to do, he will put you under leadership. It's either a leadership that is visible or a leadership that is not visible. The reason is, when we are under leadership, it helps us to have the control. When we are under leadership, it gives us a sense of direction. When we are under leadership, it brings us to a place of accountability. When we are under leadership, it helps us to develop the fear of God. When we are under leadership, it helps us to develop the fear of God. And the Bible said that the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of God is what? It's the beginning of wisdom. If we truly want to reign in life, if we truly want to succeed in life, we're going to pay attention to the fear of God. We're going to pay attention. And the fear of God is the key to overcoming rebellious spirits. The fear of God will lead you to right actions. The fear of God will lead you to a lifestyle that is consistent with God's will. The fear of God, the scripture said, it is the beginning of wisdom. So how do we know that an individual is rebellious? It's when their conversation does not line up with God's word concerning any matter. When their conversation does not line up with God's word concerning any matter, you see an individual taking a side or an opposition when he or she should not. They take a side and they say things they ought not to say. It is that spirit that is at work in them. If people can't handle that spirit, what the spirit does is that it mutes them. There are a lot of people that are gifted, but they are trapped in rebellious spirits. And the spirit of rebellion is not a platform for greatness. It is a platform for destruction. This is why you can see someone who is very gifted, very intelligent, but they are stuck. Very gifted, very intelligent. They have charisma. They have anointing. But they never went forward with their life because they were unable to deal with these spirits called a rebellious spirit. It is the spirit that gives you a false identity that, hey, I don't think I can be here. This is not a place for me. Then it gives a false identity to people. And it makes them step out of bounds and start acting contrary to God's word. Then it has consequences. It has consequences. Rebellious spirit is one of the spirits that brings setbacks in people's lives. It sends people backward, either in ministry, either in business, either in your organization. These spirits can bring setbacks. It can cause people to stagnate in life. It can cause people to lose focus of their future. It can cause, this is the spirit that leads to suicide. This spirit opens the door for early death. One of the reasons why most people died early, some people died early, it was not because they were sick. It was because this spirit led them into action that destroyed their future. And led them to an action. They started doing things they ought not to do. They started saying things they ought not to say. Let me tell this to you. One of the reasons why people can get involved in this spirit is when they become familiar with authority. Familiarity with authority can open door for rebellion. Familiarity can open door for rebellion. I don't want to be familiar with my pastor. My pastor, she's a woman. I submit to her, a woman of God, and she has a husband. Her husband is not a pastor. But when I see the husband, I call him a respect. Why? Because she's still a comrade to my pastor. But the man is not an apostle. He's not a prophet. He's not a pastor. But I have to understand how authority works. If you don't know how authority works, you can't be in the place of greatness. This is why many people can tell you, I have a bright future. I'm going to do this with my life. And 10 years has passed, nothing is going to happen. 20 years has passed, nothing is going to happen. 25 years has passed, nothing is going to happen. A particular TV station tracked us today, and they said, yesterday they called up and said, we'll show some of your videos. Can we be able to use them on our TV station? And they said they need an approval. What was that? They were coming under authority. They didn't go to YouTube and start pulling the videos and start airing on their TV station. They have to send me an email today. I have to respond back the email as an approval that will give them an approval to air it on their TV station. And see, when people are not under authority, they are the worst people to keep company. You know what? The spirit of rebellion does not allow people to receive leadership. The spirit of rebellion does not allow people to receive leadership because receiving leadership brings protection and security. One thing that brings protection and security into your life is when you choose to receive leadership. How is my life going? What is going to be the direction of my future? Where is God taking me to? I need to begin to learn not to allow the spirit to jump into my life. No way. I don't want the spirit to jump on me, to jump on what God has told me to do. I choose the path of loyalty. Loyalty is not weakness. Loyalty is strength. Being loyal is not a sign that you're weak. Being loyal is not a sign that you're stupid. Being loyal is an indication that you're securing your future and you're building on the right platform. This is why Joseph, with everything he went through, nothing stopped him from getting to his destiny. Why? Loyalty opens the door of greatness. Loyalty opens the door of greatness. Joseph had an opportunity to be rebellious. When he had the opportunity to meet the wife of Potiphar, he declined because he knew that God has trusted him with a season. Can I say this to you? If God trusts you with a season, one thing you cannot fight against is your rebellious spirit. When God trusts you with a season, whenever God wants to bring you to the front line, one thing that fights you, I want to say this to you, to every leader watching me, to every pastor watching me around the world, whenever God wants to lift you up, maybe you work for an organization, maybe you serve in a ministry, or you do something, one thing that will attack your mind is called a rebellious spirit. And when that spirit wants to attach himself to you, you have to quickly say, no. You have to
to finish that word? No. Because if you don't say no, that same spirit can turn into a coward. That same spirit. That was what destroyed the destiny of Judas. That was why Judas couldn't make it to the top. This is why most anointed people commit suicide. This is one of the reasons why people will build a large building, but they never saw the place get filled. Before the place didn't get filled, they are dead. Why? This spirit opens door for suicide. And I heard God say, tell my people, if you allow this spirit to attach on your body, attach your ministry, attach whatever you're doing, you're getting yourself ready for trouble. Why? Because it's a spirit that doesn't care. And it's a spirit that will, and you can see someone that have a bright future, but it snatched the future away from them. It snatched that dream away from them. It snatched that promise away from them. He said, but I know that this girl has a bright future. I knew that this girl has a bright future, but rebellion has destroyed the future and opened the grave when they ought not to die. This one is my God. I've seen it for 20 years of preaching the gospel. I've seen people set themselves up for any days. For 20 years of preaching the gospel, I've seen people that had a promising future, a great future. They were on their way to their future. Then they find short of and rebellion coming. Let me say this to you. As you're serving God, Satan is waiting. Let me tell you this. As you are serving God, going after the things of God, you have an enemy. And the mission of your enemy is that you don't finish your purpose.
No way.
This is the mission of Satan. You don't finish your purpose. Do you know that adultery is a mark of rebellion? Adultery is a mark of rebellion. Do you know when people begin to gossip against leadership, it's a mark of rebellion? Do you know that when people begin, maybe something was going on in their home, and if you went to people's house, then you saw them fighting, and instead of you being there to be a blessing and see how you could help them resolve the matter, then you spread the matter everywhere, you know what you're doing? You're getting yourself ready for trouble. But most people don't understand that whenever God gives us an opportunity to minister to people, one of the things he seeks was humility. A humble spirit will break through. A humble spirit will always win. A humble spirit will always stand the test of time. And this is why many people think that, oh, I am anointed. If you think you are anointed and you are not humble, you have no future. If you think you are anointed and you're not humble, you have no future. You can't get to your destiny by yourself. You can't fulfill your destiny by yourself. There are principles of the spirit. So there are reasons why people are getting mad. Young people, losing their mind. Yeah. But losing their mind, behaving like someone who is lost. Losing their mind. Why is some people, the way they behave, you wonder what is the problem? Whenever you see people in some situation, there is something connected to it. Things don't just happen. Someone can initiate the struggle. I said, things don't just happen. Someone can do what can initiate the struggle. Someone can create a problem. Someone can open the door for a wind of crisis, for a wind of storm, for a wind of challenges. And this is what the Bible said in Romans 12, verse 3, said, be a transformer. By the renewing of your mind. Because when your mind is renewed and someone comes to give you a suggestion, a wrong suggestion, you say, no, I'm not going this way. If your friend chooses to rebel, you shouldn't be rebellious. Why? Because that rebellion, when the wind comes, the harvest of rebellion, that is called harvest of rebellion. Let me tell you what is the harvest of rebellion. It comes with arrogance, it comes with internal frustration. It comes with limitation. It comes with things that has to do with people losing their stocks. People losing what belongs to them. People running into losses. You work for an office and things are not working well. Don't try to rebel against the leadership of that office. Don't try to say, me today, as I'm going to the office, I'm going to fight my boss. No, don't do that. Even if your boss is not doing well, be careful that you don't fight him. Because you may start your decision tomorrow and someone is coming after you. Why? Well, when we sow seed, our seed don't just live our life, they follow us into our future. Your seed will always follow you into your future. A lot of people don't know this. What is going on the earth today is that this spirit called rebellion have destroyed nations. Have destroyed nations, have destroyed marriages, have destroyed ministries, have destroyed the callings of people, have destroyed the destinies of people that have a bright future. Those that you saw and he said this guy had a great future, he's going somewhere. His inability to address the spirit brought him to a place of humiliation. Why do you think that Absalom never made it? Absalom, great guy, great. But what happened? When the spirit of rebellion comes in, it shut down everything that God has started. When it comes into people's life, it has the ability to shut things down. Shut things down. Shut things down. And these struggles we can explain, why can't I break through? And sometimes we need to begin to, the Bible said, examine yourself. And see, we get to examine ourselves to look if we're really walking in the path of God's word. We got to examine ourselves if we are really doing things according to the will of God. We need to examine ourselves that we don't live our life like people who have lost focus or purpose. We got to examine ourselves. We got to examine ourselves because when you examine yourself, why did James walk away from God? Why? But James walked away from God. I just want to say this. So in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 9 to 11, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 9 and 11, and we heard Paul lamenting, and he said that James has forsaken me, having love for this present world. He said that James have forsaken me. Well, where was James going to? What was the intention of James? Demas was connected to this great apostle that was a mighty man of God. But Demas lost focus of purpose. When people lose focus of purpose, you know what they do? They just be going around life like that. They just be going around life like that. Because they have lost focus. They have lost focus. People like Nehemiah were in a situation where they could be rebellious. But he chose not to. He heard that the walls of Jerusalem was down. And this guy went to the king in humility and said, and take permission. Nehemiah understood leadership. One of the keys to the success of Nehemiah was his ability to recognize leadership. Was his ability to understand the energy that flows from leadership. He went to his boss and said, this is what is happening. I need to go fix something. Will you give me a permission? And the boss said yes. Look at the man called Daniel. He was in a situation where he ought to compromise. He ought to be rebellious. He ought to be angry. But what did Daniel do? And when the king came to look at the situation, he said, oh, king, live forever. He was not rebellious against the king. Let me say this to you. If situation will make you rebellious, it means you're not rooted in character. If situation will make you to be rebellious, it means you're not rooted in character. Because godly character is the foundation for greater possibilities. Godly character, kingdom character, lifestyle of the spirit. Lifestyle of the spirit. Hallelujah. Lifestyle of the spirit. There is something that God demands from you. I don't believe in that message that people say, just do whatever you want to do. You're a Christian, do whatever you want to do. God cannot be angry with you. God cannot be offended with you. Just go around, live and sin, do whatever you want to do. No, you can. Your grace is not weak. Grace is not weakness. Grace is God empowering you to live the blood life. Grace is not weak. Grace is God's empowerment to live the God life. We can't truly live the God life by mind. We can only live the God life through grace. We are saved by grace to live by grace. I said we are saved by grace to live by grace. Grace is God empowering you to live according to his will. Grace is God empowering you to live according to his will. We can't truly live according to the will of God. We start walking in the revelation of the grace of God. And when Reuben came to walk in the revelation of his grace,
we are going to distance ourselves from this great covenant. This is what caused confusion in churches, the covenant. What was Judas the Carrier looking for in the lives of all of you? What was Judas looking for when he took the 30 pieces of silver? He was looking for opportunity. He was looking for more money. He was looking for platform. He was looking for something that he never knew that has no future. That was what he was looking for. And this is why someone like Judas missed the talent. He missed the talent because he started focusing on what he shouldn't be focusing on. And this is why a lot of people have crippled their greatness because their focus is not consistent with God's word. Their focus. Why can't be rebellious? There are rebellious wives. There are rebellious husbands. There are rebellious children. Because they choose, their parents is telling them, don't do this, they will do opposites. The husband said, I don't want that woman you're keeping company with. That woman is not healthy for our relationship. That woman is our best friend. That's how you know rebellious people. How do you know rebellious people? They relate to other rebellious people. They join people who rather. They join the camp of people who, when something is going wrong, you see them building camps. How do you know rebellious people? It is in his house or in her house where all the discussion goes on. All the issues, yeah, discussing it. How can I make my house better? No, not my house. God didn't give me the house for that kind of thing. God gave me a home to have peace and have joy and live a better life. Hallelujah. That's why God gave me the home. God didn't give me a home for me to have all the matters that is going on. Not just from my house. You can't do that to my house. No, I don't want that around me. You go fix it where you have to go and fix it. And can I say this to you? Every conversation you permit, you gotta check it, what you're contributing in the conversation. You gotta check what you're contributing in the conversation. Because whatever you're contributing in the conversation is important. I don't want to run with the wrong crowd. I don't want to hook up with people who don't hook up with the things of the Spirit. A great man of God said, a person, they said, hand that to people of faith. Hand that for people of faith. People who are kingdom minded. People who are the will of God minded. Not selfish folks. Hand that for people who are interested in building the kingdom. Who are interested in building the kingdom. One thing God told me while I was sharing with the management, they said that rebellion will disconnect people from the plan of God for their life. They said rebellion will disconnect people from the plan of God for their life. God has a great plan for their life, but that spirit disconnects. It's a spirit that disconnects people. Someone you know very well, he saw, this lady is going somewhere. She's going to have a bright future. This guy is going to have a bright future. Then you watch their attitude, and you wonder where they're going to end up in life. Wonder. Where is this person going to end up in life? Where is life going to end up? Where are they going to be? In the next 5 years, in the next 10 years. Whenever I'm making a decision, I'm thinking about it in the long run. Whenever I'm in a conversation, I'm thinking about it in the long run. How healthy is this conversation to my faith? How healthy is this conversation to my dream, to my vision, to the things that God has called me to do? How heavy is this conversation to where I'm going to? I don't want to assimilate conversations that will keep my faith. I don't want to receive conversations that will not inspire me to make my decisions in the direction of the will of God. I don't want that. Joseph, a man who stood out, a man who chose the path of purity. One of the ways to overcome rebellion is to choose the path of submission. And submission comes by understanding. Submission comes by what? It comes by understanding. The Bible says, well, husband and wife, submit yourself to one another. Submission is not just about women. Because when we hear submission, sometimes all we think about, let my wife submit to me. There is a place of submission for the man in a relationship. Your wife got a good idea, we can partake of the idea together. to everything.
If she called my wife, come up right now and told me, let's do this, and I check it, it's consistent with God's word, then I'll follow it all. Then I'll follow it all.
Submission is not an indication of weakness. Submission is a release of strength.
I said, submission is not an indication of weakness. Submission is a release of strength.
When people choose the path of submission, they secure their future. It's through submission you begin to understand that this is the place to be. This is where God wants me to be. This is the people that God wants me to connect with. This is where God wants my life to be. This is the person God wants me to connect with. This is the person that God wants me to do things together with.
Submission is a proof of maturity.
Submission is a proof of maturity. The scripture said that God will resist the proud and he will give more grace to the humble. It said God will resist not the devil. It said God will resist the proud. The proud is rebellious. The proud is full of themselves. It said God will, you know, there, let me share one thing with my wife about this. We used to have a particular leadership in our life many years ago. And this leader wanted to marry him. And this lady would say that her wedding day, what she's going to do, that they will use play to share the invitation card and things like that, that they will do their wedding, you know, all kinds of things she was saying, you know, she would look down on people, she would talk down on people, she would do things that is so horrible. I was under that kind of leadership. But for one day, we never fought. For one day, I submitted to them to a point that they were guilty about my submission. They were guilty about my submission. And you know what happened? After many years, the wedding took place, it was not in the aircraft. The person who attended the wedding was telling me they were looking for money. He said the wedding hall, they have no money to pay for things. You see, what happened is that rebellious spirit caused them to exalt themselves beyond measure, then it brings them down.
Huh? Hey, to exalt themselves beyond measure, then it crushes them.
I was just praying for all of you while I was like, people this time, I was praying for people that would hear this message. I said, God, may they catch this message. May the people know you in their life. May they catch the message. Because what people believe will determine what they become.
What people believe will determine what they become. What people choose to receive will determine what they manifest. Do you want to see a great future? Do you want to have a good life? Do you want to have a great tomorrow? Then you have to make decisions in the direction of the will of God.
Hallelujah. Say, God will resist the proud. One of my pastors used to say something to us many years ago. He said, it's too early to know who's ahead. It's early to know who is ahead.
Ahead.
He said, I'm not asking, I'm telling you.
Yeah,
yeah. Boy, God. He said, I'm not asking you. He said, I'm telling you. He said, it is early to know who is ahead. It is early. Maybe someone may think is ahead of you right now. It is early to know who is ahead. It is early. It is too early to judge your future. It is early to judge your destiny. It is early to judge what you're doing. You just trust God and walk by faith, and you stay on that spirit, and you begin to do things according to God's word. So mission is a major part of our faith work. When Jesus was talking, he said, we are sheep. He said, my sheep will hear my voice. He never said, goats will hear my voice. He never said, my goats. Imagine Jesus saying, we are goats. He never talked about that. He said, my sheep will hear my voice, and the voice of a stranger, they will not follow. Do you know that someone can be loyal until he meets someone that says they're wrong against them? Do you know that someone can be very loyal, and it's loyal serving, it's loyal doing things? Many years ago, I have a spiritual father. When he was alive, my pastor is not this kind of person who always speak good and poor people. He's not that kind of person. And one time someone asked me, do you really think that your pastor, do you think that if your pastor likes you? Do you think that your pastor loves you? Do you think that your pastor really wants to have a relationship with him? You know what I told the person? I said, please, I don't want you talking about my pastor. I want you to talk about my relationship with you and leave my pastor off this conversation. I love my pastor and I love his character. I'm satisfied with who he is. He said, if we are not careful, we'll be saying things we ought not to say, then we'll get ourselves to watch on.
We were saying things we don't want to say. Someone met me several years ago. He said, how do you relate to your pastor? He's a very principled person. How? I said, just know what is right to do. Tell him, do it. You have a relationship with great people. Because rebellion sometimes begins with someone giving you a wrong idea about an individual and the person who are inability to feed the idea that will strive without knowledge. Because we're not willing to listen. We're not willing to follow. Let me ask you this question. 30 years from now, how will your life look like? Have you asked yourself that question? In the next 30 years, how will you look like? I'd like you to just have a picture of your next 30 years. Maybe you're watching it right now, you're watching this service live. Now, I want you to have a picture of your next 30 years. Add 30 years to your present age and ask yourself this question, what I am doing right now, with my lifestyle right now, what is my 30 years going to be like? Some people here, in your next 30 years, you're going to be 70 years old. Some people here, in your next 30 years, you're going to be 80 years old. Some that are watching me right now, in your next 30 years, you're going to be 50 years old, or you're going to be 80 years old, or 90 years old. But the question I'm asking you is, how will you look? What kind of life? What kind of influence? Who are you going to, who will even mention, who will look at you and say, your life was an inspiration to me? Who will look at you and say, you are a great inspiration to my life? Can I say this to you? Don't just live for what you can get, live for what you can leave behind. Don't just live for what you can get, live for something you can leave behind. Always think about legacy in your decision. Always think about landmark in your decision. Always think about being a reference point in your decision. Always think about being an inspiration in your decision. Always think about living a life that is based on the will of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
We can destroy the root of the spirit and say, I am not going to be rebellious. I'm going to be a humble person.
Yeah.
I'm going to be a diligent person. I'm going to be a person who respects authority. I'm going to be a person who submits to integrity. I'm going to be a person of honor. I'm going to be a person that lives a lifestyle that glorifies God. When you choose to be rebellious, your children are seeing it, and one day they are going to manifest that. I used to take my children to my pastor, and everybody have their offering. Let them know that it's a pastor. So everybody give their offering. It's time to give offering. And one of the days, everybody was giving the offering, and she collected the offering and said, all of this offering for me will laugh and say, yes, mama. You teach your children how to honor. If you don't teach your children how to honor, then you're setting them up for Christ. You teach them to honor. You see, there is a lifestyle. See, when I was growing up, I wasn't taught most of this when I was growing up. But as I came to Jesus and had a relationship with him, he started showing me some things that I missed from where I was coming from. He started showing me what it means to be a father, what it means to be a mentor, what it means to be healed, what it means to be raised. Most people are living with their father, but they were not mentored. Most people are living with their mother, but they were not mentored. But sometimes mentorship is not just in communication. It can be someone modeling a lifestyle that inspires you to take action in the right direction. A mentor is not someone who always says something to you. A mentor is someone whose lifestyle brings a conviction to your action. It may not say everything to you. Maybe someone whose lifestyle brings a conviction to your action that your way of thinking experiences change as a result of looking at this authority, this leader in your life. Hallelujah. Submission, it pays to submit. It pays to be loyal. It pays to be humble. It pays to be gentle. It pays to be kind. You see your leader, good afternoon, Pastor. Good evening, Pastor. Where I was coming from, we don't stand to beat our pastor. We don't have to bow before our leader. We don't, that's what we are taught. We don't say, hey, Pastor. That's what we are taught. No. No one will lead our lives. We knew that if you don't have hunger for your leader, it makes you get into more trouble. We knew that. I was taught that. We're hunger of a leader. And this is one of the keys to ministry longevity success. How can your pastor give you a call? And you know, someone saw his pastor calling him.
Okay, I don't want to talk to him right now.
So the pastor was calling. He never knew the purpose why the pastor was calling. He has no food in his mind. Maybe he wants to ask for money. Maybe he wants to tell me something. I don't have that time for that. Can I say this to you? If you truly want to succeed in your assignment, your attitude will determine it. If you truly want to succeed in your assignment, your attitude will determine that. I come from a place where when people want to marry, sometimes they want to ask a question. Before they know about that lady, what do you know about that man? They ask questions. The place where I come from, people don't just jump into marriage. They don't make questions, they don't make inquiry. They don't try to ask people that know the people that know the people that know the people. Hallelujah. Yes, they will ask a question. They're going to go to all the generations of us. Well, is that girl going to be a good girl? Because they were not married for divorce, they were married for longevity. They were married for purpose. They were willing to do this according to God's word. I'm tired of a generation that can't stand truth. I'm tired of a generation that is not willing to listen to God's word. Because the scripture says in the last days, they will hear teachers of themselves having itching ears. Having itching ears. Not ready for the truth. So why are you talking to me like that? Why are you telling me that? Do you know that your future is already written down?
Yeah.
Do you know that God has a great plan for you? But you can abort it.
Let me say this to you. You can abort the will of God for your life. If you can decide not to do God's will for your life, you can decide. You can decide, I don't want to do the will of God.
You can decide. Judas had an opportunity to be an apostle. Then he was a real apostle once he turned himself to a false apostle.
The first false apostle was Judas.
The first, he was a genuine apostle at the beginning of the calling, but later he lost focus. And then what happened?
He became a false apostle.
Uh-huh.
How many Judas do we have today in the church? Looking for money. Looking for opportunity to betray. Those that can betray people for a bottle of drink. Those that can betray people for a 5 packet of biscuits. And they will just betray. I don't care. Give me this thing to talk. As long as you just give them to him, their mouth begins to run. They say, why this is yesterday? Now you come to you don't know what happened in church yesterday. Oh, you don't know what happened last week. Hey, they are running. So you just get them missing. At the end of this kingdom, they are offloading everything. Even the truth and the lie, they say, no, it's going to mix it together.
And the sister said, I'm going to bring you bangasu and I'm going to bring you also pomo and something.
And they're just open. And they just, they lose their best. And then they begin to pour out.
Even both truth and lie. Listen together. I said, give me more.
He said, no, I'm very, very close to the pastor. I'm very, very close to the pastor. So everything I tell you is true. That somebody is close to me, they know me. That someone is close to me doesn't mean they know me. They don't have an idea of who I am. They don't have a clue of who I am. But you see, when people are looking for favor from people, they can say anything to get favor. They can say that, you know what about life? Whatever people be driven to guess doesn't last. Yes, it's true. Yes, it's true. Whatever people take from people, it doesn't last. Whatever God wants you to have, if you stay in place, it will come to you. Whatever God wants you to experience, if you stay in place, it will come to you. It says the blessings of the Lord make it rich and have no sorrow. Stop trying to take what belongs to folks.
God has a plan for your life.
Amen.
Stop trying to take what belongs to folks. I see pastors do it in ministry. They go around people's churches and looking for who they are going to slip some number to, slip something to, and just connive. All of those things can take you wrong.
far.
He said, the blessings of the Lord make them rich.
Rich.
And he adds to the soul. I want to live a blessed life.
Yeah.
I want to live a life that is based on the will of God. I want to live a life that projects the image of Jesus. I want to live a life that the Lord can see. This is my beloved son, and him I'm well pleased. Jesus is not the only son. I am also a son. And my son, the sinner son, has made up the need to let him come the power to become the sons of God. Jesus is the firstborn of all the brethren. And once you obey God and live by his word, you will be a well-beloved son, pleasing son, blessed son. Hallelujah.
Yeah, amen.
Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
Glory be to God.
Hallelujah.
So God wants me to live according to his word and make his will my priority. And this is how you get more blessed. This is how you get more blessed. This is how you profit. This is how you win in life. God told me this. He said, rebellion is Satan's major stronghold. Rebellion is Satan's major stronghold. It's Satan's major stronghold. The major stronghold of Satan is rebellion. It's a major stronghold. It uses against the destinies of people. It uses to destroy, to build people. It uses to build the futures of people.
The major stronghold.
If you have a future, stay out of rebellion.
If there are areas where you need to repent and God will have mercy on you, but stay out of rebellion. It will destroy everything you're building.
I'm telling you, I've seen the effect of that spirit in the lives of people for more than 20 years of preaching the gospel. I've seen this thing ruin the destinies of people. Great people turn into nothing. Look at Samson, the mighty man of God. When Samson stepped out of the will of God, what happened? He lost his eyes. He lost his eyes. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Whenever people step out of the will of God, what is that? They are rebelling against God's purpose. They are rebelling against God's order. Because there is something God has called you to do. There is something you are anointed for. There is something God has called you to do. No sickness and disease is connected to rebellious spirit. Can I say this one more time? When people step out of the will of God, they can be afflicted. I said, when people step out of the will of God, they can be afflicted. Affliction sometimes comes when people begin to live contrary to God's word. It opens up for affliction. Sin and sickness connects. I said, what? Sin and sickness connects. And this is why we need to live by the word. The word of God is a medicine. God's word is a medicine. See, it pays to live a holy life. I still believe in holiness. I still believe in purity. I still, someone said, I was spend my life old fashioned. You still believe in holiness? Yes, I like being old fashioned and be holy. I want the old fashioned that is what? That is holy. I don't want a new generation with sin. I want a whole generation of holiness, righteousness, consciousness, faith in God, hallelujah. That is how we all started many years ago. Glory be to God. Faith in God, holiness, purity, abstain from every evil appearance. You dress properly, you dress to cover your body, hallelujah.
Amen.
Don't believe in things like that. Come on, can I hear better? Amen. Somebody
amen.
Here. The blessings of the Lord make them rich and have more what?
No sorrow.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, the blessings of the dress of them, and you see how every part of their body bunches up. What's wrong with you? Who tell you came there to look at your body? You learn to dress modestly. I believe in fashion. I believe in people dressing well. But not like people dressing in such a way that every part of you that is supposed to be covered is exposed. No. Let's think well. Let's behave well. Let's be the light of our generation.